白玉标。And welcome to St. Paul. Time to give thanks for all the wonderful gifts we have been given. Even though you might not have gotten to celebrate with family and friends, Christmas 2020 was still about the angels appearing to the shepherds, the star leading the way to the manger, and the birth of Jesus. Dear Lord, thank you for blessing us with the birth of your Son, whom you sent down to earth to save us from our sins. Would you now please join me in the prayer our Father gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, St. Paul's. We are delighted that you are joining us for worship on this first Sunday after Christmas and the last Sunday of 2020. It is with heavy hearts that we remember the sudden loss of Bob Wolf last Sunday morning. Bob was a beloved choir member and leader in our church, and just a kind and faithful servant of God, and we miss him very much, and our prayers are with Marty and his family on his loss. We also celebrate with Paul and Jackie Deaton today on their 68th wedding anniversary. A reminder that you can find all of the updates of the joys and the prayer requests for our St. Paul's community in the Google Doc that we share every week in our email. Now, please join me in prayer. Living One, born to make all things new, renew our spirits today. May we open our arms to receive your love and to spread your good news wherever it is needed most. We pray today for your healing light to reach all those who are hurting. We ask that your presence lift up those who mourn and restore those who are weary. For the great loss of your beloved servant, Bob Wolf, we grieve with broken hearts. We trust that he is at peace in your eternal care. May his family and friends who feel his absence so deeply hold your words of hope close and take comfort in knowing that he walks with you. Sustain us, Lord, as we wait for the light of dawn to break over our world, bringing an end to violence, bringing forgiveness where we cling to regret, bringing reconciliation to enemies, and strength to all those working for justice. As we cling to the joy of your arrival, Holy One, may we stay focused on following you. May we grow in wisdom and understanding by listening to your teachings. May we multiply your gifts of mercy, compassion, and love in how we live each and every day. At this time, when we rejoice in the story of your birth, we also give thanks for the new babies among us who remind us of the great vulnerability and delight with which you became flesh. Teach us to delight in each day as we come to know you ever better. Amen.
Sweet. Good morning. This morning, I want to reflect on a song that we sing to our boys when they wake up anytime, whether it's nap time or in the morning. And the chorus is, "We're all in our places with sunshiny faces." And the Christ child is born, and we've had these big sunshiny moments, but I also remember that we've had plenty of times where we're all in our places, but our faces aren't sunshiny. 2020 has brought a myriad of feelings and experiences of grief and loneliness, but also times of great joy and celebration. So this Sunday after Christmas, as we come to the communion table, I hope that you come to this place and find peace. Find the peace that Christ hoped to bring and break into this world. That when you, whether you are alone or you are with family, or you're welcomed into a new place, that you come to this table and find the peace of Christ in this bread and this cup, and that it may sustain you and fulfill you as we go towards the new year.
God has always sought to commune with his children. He has established times and places where this glorious experience could take place. He has invited individuals and groups, congregations, tribes, and nations into his holy fellowship. To the ancient Israelites, the mercy seat represented God's presence. The fellowship before the mercy seat probably involved much the same sweet sense of belonging to one another and to the Heavenly Father as that which one feels when we come together about the communion table. This communion is more than a sentiment or a tradition. It's a sense of being caught up into a relationship greater than ourselves. It is feeling that we belong to one another and to God. It is a rapture of spiritual release. For us about the communion table, it is infinitely more. It is dedication. It is a willingness to share hardship and suffering, sacrifice and death with one whose body was broken and whose blood was shed. Communion at the Lord's table is the reaffirmation of blood in sisterhood and in brotherhood. It is giving and receiving of forgiveness. It is gratitude and it is generosity. It is the breaking of the alabaster box of ointment, the pouring out of lavish devotion and unconditional love. We celebrate, Holy God, the elements of Holy Communion. The bread is symbolic of our Lord's broken body. The wine is symbolic of the blood shed on the cross as a sign of forgiveness of our sins. Thank you, Jesus, for being our mentor and friend and Lord. Amen.
Gathered around a table with his disciples, Jesus took the bread. He blessed it and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Every time you eat this, do it in remembrance of me." After supper, he also took the cup and said, "This is a new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this cup, know that my love and forgiveness flow through you."
As we prepare for our prayer of thanksgiving, your offerings by mail and by electronic transfers are very much appreciated. Now our prayer of thanksgiving. Most Heavenly Father, Creator of everything good, both in heaven and on earth, the one that provides all of our needs, we praise your holy name. We come to you in this holy season, celebrating your most precious gift of all, with the birth of your Son, Jesus. In these times of uncertainty, we look to him for guidance and assurance that he will watch over us and provide for our needs. Help us to follow his teachings and better serve our brothers in need. Let us show our gratitude by returning to you our gifts of thanksgiving. Bless our offerings we now make. In your most holy name we pray. Amen.
Love, peace, and joy.
and they offered a sacrifice, according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simon came into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Are we there yet? If we were on an epic road trip together, asking this question for the 500th time from the back seat, then we finally might get the answer that we've been waiting for. We spent the 4 weeks of Advent preparing to welcome the Christ child on Christmas, and that day has come. However we celebrated Christmas this year, at this point, the candles have been lit, the presents have been unwrapped, and at least in my house, all the cookies have been eaten. For over 9 months now, many of us have been eagerly anticipating the end of this roller coaster of a year. And in a few short days, 2020 will finally be behind us. Over the past months, we have looked forward to election results, to approved coronavirus vaccines, and to other milestones in our lives that have now been realized. Other hopes that we hold, like being able to gather safely again, seem to be within our reach if we can just be patient a little while longer. Today's scripture is the story of a long-awaited dream come true at last. Simon has been longing to see the Messiah, waiting his whole life for the promised Savior, knowing that he could not rest in peace until God's anointed appeared. Jesus shows up, and Simon holds the Messiah in his arms. When we have looked forward to something for so long, and it finally arrives, we may find that we aren't fully prepared for it. What now? When the thing that we have anticipated is in front of us, when we arrive at our intended destination, then we are faced with figuring out what comes next. After Christmas, many of us may feel sadness that the celebrations are over. We may quickly move on to making New Year's plans and resolutions to have something else to focus on. There's a reason that stores so quickly put up supplies for the next holiday before the current one is even here. Even when we experience long-expected heartbreak or bittersweet milestones, a child leaves home for college or for work, a terminal illness ends the life of a loved one, we feel at a loss about how to live into the new reality once it is actually upon us. Tom Petty may have gotten it wrong. The waiting may not be the hardest part after all. As much as we don't like to wait, sometimes the arrival of what we've been waiting for can be even more unsettling. To cope with the waiting, we have convinced ourselves that when we finally reach our destination, when we finally get there, that everything will just fall into place, that life will automatically be easier, happier, better. But instead, we just might find that much is still required of us, that we have different work to do. Howard Thurman wrote a beautiful poem capturing this place where we find ourselves, called The Work of Christmas. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flocks, the work of Christmas begins to find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among others, to make music in the heart. Instead of things getting easier when Jesus finally arrives, it turns out that even more difficult tasks wait for us as we discover what it means to follow this Messiah. We have dreamed of the Savior's coming, the Savior that will bring us healing and release. But the Savior gives us a role to play in bringing about that future. If we have truly embraced the time of waiting, then we may find that the waiting has prepared us for the work to be done after Christmas. We have been waiting and watching for the turn of the calendar from 2020 to 2021. Since last March, we have pinned our hopes on the day when the pandemic ends and we can finally throw away our masks and all gather back in these pews for worship, when we can invite all of our friends over for a great big dinner party, when we can cheer on our favorite team in the stands, surrounded by thousands of other fans. But waiting for that day has changed us. We may not yet know exactly what new work waits for us when the doors of the church and the stadiums and our homes are opened wide again. But I'm pretty sure that life will not suddenly be all sunshine, roses, and national championships. We will find ourselves still longing for gatherings that are less divided and more equitable. We will still be dreaming of a society in which Black lives truly matter and the hungry are fed, of a climate that is sustainable for future generations. And we will know that we are the ones who have to help bring that into being. And so, while we are waiting for our hopes to be realized, I hope that we will let ourselves be changed by the waiting. Let's not passively mark the days until the calendar changes. Instead, let's make ourselves ready to welcome the arrival of the good news. Simon and Anna are prepared to welcome the Messiah, even though he doesn't show up in the way most people expected. They have spent their days in prayer and study in the temple so that they recognize the Christ child instantly. Simon is ready to die in peace now that he has seen this long-awaited one. He doesn't fear what comes next, even though he knows that it will bring conflict and heartbreak. And in fact, he warns Mary of the troubles to come. We know that even though God became flesh and lives among us, even though so many things we long for feel like they are in our reach, many challenges still lie ahead. Maybe the arrival of vaccines and the return to social gatherings can be a chance for us to learn how to connect with our neighbors in more meaningful ways. Maybe as we remove our masks, we can also be inspired to remove the barriers to true racial reconciliation. Maybe the much-anticipated end of 2020 can mean that we begin a new year committed to loving and living differently, with more presence and more compassion, with less division and less judgment. Fourth century Bishop Gregory of Nyssa said, "Every fulfillment continually generates a further desire. This discovery, far from making the soul despair, is actually an experience of God's fuller presence." The arrival of one long-awaited event opens our eyes to all the work and struggle that is still in front of us. This is not a cause for despair, but for joy. That we are continually hoping, dreaming of God's plans coming ever more fully into fruition. That we are a part of making creation ever more like God intended. That we are aligning our lives, our work, with that of the Messiah, who is always being born into our lives again and again. We seek and we wait. We receive the good news. And that good news moves us to seek Christ's arrival in this time and this place in new ways. The good news is never finished being told, being lived, being born into our lives in fresh ways. Amen.
Nature.
As we close today, I want to thank my family who let me recruit them to help with worship today. So I'm grateful for their presence and for Judy, and especially to Ross, who has helped us run our tech while Amanda is on vacation with her family. We also, I forgot to mention in our prayers earlier, our prayers are extended to the folks in downtown Nashville, where there was an explosion this week. I know many of us who have served as ministers at St. Paul's lived not far from that place in downtown Nashville, and so we remember folks affected by that. A few reminders of things coming up at St. Paul's in the coming weeks. We did on Christmas Eve get to enjoy some prayer stations around Christmas theme set up around the church that were safely distanced. And so if anyone wants another opportunity to engage in those prayer stations, we can have them open this afternoon between 4:30 and 6. But if you want to participate in that, we do ask that you RSVP for that by noon. We won't open the buildings up unless we know folks are coming for that. So RSVP if you'd like to come this afternoon at 4:30 to enjoy some Christmas prayer stations. We also are gearing up for a new year and new educational programs. So adult Bible study will begin again on January 7th. It will meet by Zoom on Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. And so the links for that are in our weekly email if you'd like to participate in the Bible study starting January 7th on Zoom. And our theme is going to be the Sermon on the Mount. And we'll be using a study by A.J. Levine. And finally, next Sunday would normally be our birthday party for Jesus breakfast and celebration. And while we won't be gathering together for breakfast, we do want to invite you, if you'd like to give a birthday gift for the baby, that you give those this year to children who are in the hospital this holiday season, and some gifts that help the nurses and the doctors that are caring for them. So in our midweek email, we have a wish list for toys and gifts that can be sent to UNC Children's Hospital or to Wake Med's Child Life Program. So you can choose one of those gifts and have it sent directly to the hospital. And finally, on January 11th, that's a Monday evening at 7 p.m., we will have a St. Paul's board meeting by Zoom. So all of that information will be in our weekly emails. And now I invite you to join me in our benediction. Please read along with the words in bold that are printed on your screen. Lord, dismiss your servants in peace, according to your word. For our eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to those who seek you, and for the glory to all people. Amen.